Last week, if you were with us, Pastor Art talked about the story of a man standing on the brink, one needing to make a decision that was going to change his life forever. And he kind of left us with this, ourselves kind of standing on the brink of what's going to happen next. Well, this morning we get to figure out what's going to happen next. So we're going to pick up the conversation between Nicodemus and Jesus and continue, and it continues with one of the most recognizable passages in all of Scripture. We see it in stadiums. Shout out to the Vikings. Apparently, they were about to miss a field goal, so that's cool. But you can note just under the field goal post, there is a, well, we're not there yet, sorry. We have a little John 3:16 banner. You've probably seen it at a football game. We also have football players, specifically in college. They could write little things on their eye black. So here we have Tim Tebow in all his glory with John 3:16 written on his eye black. There is so much meaning to this passage, and one that has significant impact on our lives today. If you have a Bible, we're going to be in the Gospel of John, and this is what it says. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Most of us, just about every one of us, could probably quote this passage in our sleep. But it is the most famous summary about God's desires in all of Scripture. A few things to note as we go forward this morning. God loved the world. Not just the chosen nation of Israel, God loved all humans, all humankind, all mankind, right? He loves you, he loves me. He loves the people of Ukraine. He loves the people of Russia. He loves the Donald Trumps, the Joe Bidens, and the Vladimir Putins of our world. God loves every single human, regardless of race, creed, gender, or sexual orientation. You see, Jesus didn't just come for the Jewish people. He was sent for everyone. This wasn't just a God saying, hey, if you worship me, I'm going to do something really cool. No, no, no. This was the God leading with a specific action for the world. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. Let's pray. Jesus, those words are such an important reminder for us, even in our culture today. God, as we take a couple moments to engage with what is written in John chapter 3 this morning, God, I just pray that you will give us a heart and a mind and a soul to engage with what you have for us this morning. God, we're grateful that we can even gather for worship this morning. We are aware of what's taking place in our world, God, but we know that you are bigger than all of those things. God, as we just take a couple moments to connect with you, God, I just pray that these words would be your words and not my words. And all God's people said, amen. All right. As we continue this morning, I want you to think about some of the things that you love. And I need to walk a little off stage because, well, that just seemed to be a little distracting as I was walking up. So here we are. We're going to talk about things that John loves. Yay! Okay. All right. When I was a kid, I absolutely loved the show Power Rangers. I was a member of the Mighty Morphin Power Ranger fan club. Woo! I had just about all the toys, and I would say that the Power Rangers were my life. I would go as a Power Ranger for Halloween, right? If you're ever in my office, I have lots of fun things. So there you go. There's the Tiger Zord. Good times, right? When I was younger, I told my sister, right? The perfect day for me would be to wake up, to watch Power Rangers, and to go back to bed. I didn't need to eat. I didn't need water. I didn't need to go to the bathroom. All I wanted to do was to wake up, watch Power Rangers, and go back to bed. Well, as we sit here in our the 2020s, right, that can actually probably be a little bit of a reality because of this pandemic thing, right? We're all sick of talking about it. But because of a pandemic and little things we like to call Netflix or streaming services, I could live the dream of little John when he was a kid. There might have been days like that. All right, another thing that I loved as a kid is a restaurant in Denver called Casa Bonita. right? You can see, if you have your phone, you can Google it because it's been in the headlines because they just were sold. But Casa Bonita is this iconic restaurant in Denver. People will line up for hours just to have the opportunity to go into this restaurant. It has some of the best, worst, or worst, best Mexican food that you could ever experience, and I absolutely love it. Just look at that, right? Man, those are the days. Currently it's closed, but that's all right. Okay. Casa Bonita to me was my Disneyland. You see, they have a giant waterfall, they have cliff divers, they have a cave, they have an arcade. Right? They have puppet shows and magic tricks. They even have a guy running around in a giant gorilla costume. And it smells like chlorine. So there you go. Not to mention the fact that there is endless Mexican food, which, as you can tell, is delicious. here's what I will tell you, though. People will spend hours lined up just to go into this restaurant. And my family's tradition would be that we would always go on my birthday. And so one of the years we were there, not only did my brother break the record for most enchiladas eaten and then threw it up in the fountain, shout out to my brother, but there was a news reporter there that day, and he was doing a story about this iconic restaurant, Casa Bonita, right? And as he did this, he found little six-year-old John and said, I could get a quote from him, and it's going to change his life forever. And so he asked me what I thought about the restaurant, and I told him. The next morning, I woke up, and I was quoted in the newspaper of Denver. I think it was the Rocky Mountain News. Doesn't matter. I said this. I love this place. I love this so much. When I get older, I want to marry it. I didn't know that you could marry a restaurant, but sure enough, here we go. These days, I still have a great passion for a number of things. I do love lots of stuff, right? And it's all contained in a lovely little bag. Right now, I am a huge fan of the Colorado Avalanche, always have been, but right now, they are like the best team in all of hockey, so we will celebrate the Colorado Avalanche. Here's a puck signed by Gabriel Landeskog. Good times, right? If any of you know who that is, you would be excited. And so I love the Avs, right? The Avs started when I was a kid, and they won the Stanley Cup that year, and it was like, all right, let's go. We're going to win this every year. And then they didn't. And now we can't get out of the second round, so all is well. I also love another really awful team who has a lot of history, but the Denver Broncos, right? So we got little Tebow. He's probably going to fall. My mom had season tickets for the Broncos for years. We had people like John Elway and Peyton Manning and Tim Tebow. And it's just one of those like, all right, like as a Broncos fan, I will love them till I die, regardless of who their owner is, who their coach is, who their quarterback is, if they went 17-0 or 0-17, because there's an extra game now, right? So those are things that I absolutely love, right? I also love a really bad baseball team, right? The Colorado Rockies. Now, if you know anything about baseball, which isn't played right now, which is kind of a bummer, the Colorado Rapids, that's a soccer team. The Colorado Rockies, they're a team, one of the worst in baseball, but their ballpark is one of the most beautiful in all of Major League Baseball. If you ever have the opportunity and you're a baseball fan, please, please, please go to Coors Field. I love a summer night at Coors Field where the weather is absolutely perfect. There's not a ton of bugs. There's very little humidity. And you're probably going to see quite a few home runs because of the altitude, right? So those are just some of the things that I love. Now, you guys also know that I love all things Star Wars, right? So here you go, right? You got a little, all the knickknacks coming out this bag. I love Star Wars, anything that has to do with Star Wars, whether it's a movie, a TV show, Lego, right? I love Star Wars. Now, over the years, I've also started to love all things Marvel, right? And you have these Marvel movies, and let me tell you, this last Marvel movie, right? Not that picture, but the other one, right? It's called Spider-Man. You might have seen it. And it was really one of the first, like, big movies that we had in the middle of a pandemic. And so to be in a theater with people who were cheering because certain characters were appearing on the screen was unlike like anything I think I've ever encountered outside of like a worship service, right? And so I do love myself some Marvel goodness, right? Specifically Thor, which is what that set is. And as you can tell, I also love Lego. So Merry Christmas, Happy Birthday, all the good stuff. That can go there and fall. Cool. Right? These are things that I love. Now, I also love my wife. Christy always gives me a really hard time that I always talk about everything that I love, but I never mention her. And so this morning, you get to get three pictures of my wife. This is my wife and I at Disneyland on my birthday when I turned 30. This is my wife with a fish. Right? And there is us on our wedding day. Apparently, that's one of her most like favorite pictures of us as we took a selfie gearing up for our wedding. I do love Christy. I do love all of these things. And I'm sure there are things in your life that you would say, I absolutely love this. Might be skiing, might be snowmobiling, might be fishing, might be freezing to death as you sit on ice fishing or snowmobiling, right? But none of the things that we love can compare to the love that God has for us. There's a different kind of love when it comes to the love that God has for us. You are likely familiar with the term agape, which is the Greek word for love. And it's what is translated here in this passage. That's what we have, right? This love is unlike anything else that we have because it is the love that God has for humans, for humanity. John 3:16 is the perfect summary of the gospel. And as important as this passage is, it might look really good on a coffee mug or at a sign as we're at a football game, but there is so much more to this verse. And the reason that it's so critical is because of what takes place after it. So like I said, if you have your Bible, I want you to follow along as we read John 17 through 21. God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already because they do not believe in the name of God's one and only son. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but the people loved the darkness. Sound familiar to our world today? Instead of the light, because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives in the truth comes into the light so that they may be seen plainly that what they have done in the sight of God. This right here is a powerful commentary on the impact that God has on our world. Now, if you're sitting here this morning and you have your Bible out, depending on which translation you are looking at, you might actually see two different things. This idea of, was it actually said by Jesus or was it actually a commentary about John? It's that idea of the red text versus the black text. And you'll see here, one of them is ESV and one of them is the NIV. Well, over the years, scholars way smarter than I will ever be have all come together, and specifically with the NIV. They have said that these are the words of John, not necessarily the words of Jesus. And there is this shift in the tone of the language that takes place. It's not necessarily this dude specifically talking, it's not Jesus saying, hey, these are the things, but this is John breaking down, hey, these are some of the things that are going to be key to following Jesus as they have this conversation between Jesus and Nicodemus. The NIV scholars would all agree that John 3:16 through 21 is a reading of John's commentary, not me, John, gospel writer John, of the importance of the words of Jesus that he spoke to Nicodemus. Now, as we sit here today, does this change anything of what we believe about Jesus? No, it doesn't. It doesn't change anything at all, but it is just kind of a quirky thing to note. We get to this core idea of what the gospel is all about. You see, we have Jesus and Nicodemus, and they're having this conversation at night, and we begin to see the depths of what it means to follow Jesus, but also commit our lives to him. This passage is focused on the impact that the Creator had on His creation. God desires to be in a relationship with us, going to extreme measures to make it happen, even though as a culture and as a community, we will reject Him time after time after time again. What does this passage mean? It means that God is love. In a world that is filled with so much hate, so much pain, so much suffering, even as we sit here on the brink of what could be World War III, God is love. For God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish but have eternal life. God does not desire to punish His creation. God does not desire to condemn His creation. I was having a conversation with a friend recently, and she mentioned that when she was a kid, she broke her leg. And when this happened, her mom came out to her and said, well, the reason that you broke your leg is because God is punishing you, right? That's some, like, twisted theology right there. God does not desire to punish us for the things that we have done. God understands that we are broken, we are human, we are going to make mistakes. God desires to restore that brokenness. Let's break it down with a couple passages. Jumping over to Psalm 145, David says this: "The Lord is merciful and compassionate, slow to get angry, and filled with unfailing love. The Lord is good to everyone. He sows compassion on all His creation. How much does God love us? He sent His Son for us. You see, God is for you. God is for me. God is for us. He is always thinking about us. A couple psalms earlier, in Psalm 139, David writes this: "How precious are your thoughts about me, O God. They cannot be numbered. I can't even count them. They outnumber the grains of sand." If you've ever been on a beach, sand is really tiny and small. And what he's declaring is the love that God has for us is greater than the sand that is on the entire planet. "When I wake, you are still with me." God is always thinking about us because God is always caring about us. And the way that He did this is that He sacrificed His Son for us. Jumping over to the New Testament in the book of Ephesians, Paul puts it this way: "But God, so rich in His mercy, and He loved us so much that even though we were dead to our sins, He gave us life when He raised Christ Jesus from the dead. And it's only by the grace of God that you have been saved." God loves us. God loves us. God loves us. Think about that. It's more than the greatest thing that you could ever imagine. The fact that the Creator of the universe loves you. Let that sink in. Paul continues as he writes to the church in Ephesus: "Then Christ will make His home in your heart as you trust in Him. Your roots will grow down deep in God's love and keep you strong. And may you have the power to understand all these things that God desires for us. As God's people, we can experience how wide, how long, how high, and how deep His love is for us." Bless you. May you experience the love of Christ, though it is so great for us to fully understand. Then you will be made complete with all the fullness of life and the power that comes from God. When you connect with the love that God has for you, your life is made complete. Now, the reason that John 3:16 is such a powerful passage for us, such a powerful verse for us, is that it summarizes God's mission for all humankind. What does the love that God has for us actually mean? Well, John summarizes it this way: This is the verdict. Light came into the world, but people loved the darkness instead of their light, of the light, because their deeds were evil. Even in the first century, and really since the beginning of time, people were just awful. As humans, we are going to screw up. We are going to make mistakes. We are going to be selfish. We are going to hurt other humans because we do evil things. As John continues, everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives in truth comes into the light so what they have done may be seen plainly to what they have done has been done in the sight of God. Throughout the Gospel of John, there's this comparison of light and dark. Light and dark. As humans, we have a choice to make. Do we desire to live in the light, to be open to what God has for us? Or do we just want to hang out here in the darkness? Oh, and there's lights back there. I can't step into the darkness. We have this choice. Do we want to live in the hope that comes from knowing Jesus? Or do we desire to live in the darkness to hide because we're living in fear and hiding from that love? John here is describing what happens when you make a choice to believe in Jesus. You become transformed as a child of God, experience the power of the Holy Spirit, and live your life in truth. All because God is at work in our lives. That right there is the lifestyle that God is calling us to live. I would say that this lifestyle here is why we even gather on a Sunday morning to worship. We gather because of our response to what God is doing in our lives. Now, this morning, I'm going to make a massive assumption. Now, you know what happens when you make an assumption, right? But I would say that most of you know this verse, and most likely most of you know Jesus. You can explain to me why Jesus has had an impact on your life. But here's the deal. I want you to think about what you do with that information. What would our community truly look like if we were a church, if we were a community committed to this verse and sharing this love that we have in Jesus with the world around us? You see, if God is for us, we should then be for people. Who else in our world, in our culture, in our community needs to hear the message of love? God loves you. Who are you going to share that with? Now, this is not just about our lives here today as we sit or as we stand on March 6, 2022. It is this idea of eternity. Max Lucado has written a number of books, books that we've even used here, right? He actually wrote a book about John 3:16 because it's a very powerful verse. And he's re-releasing this book. And so he's going around and he's doing speaking tours and he's having these conversations with people. But he had this to say about eternity. And this is what he said. He says, "Restored completely in its pristine beauty, ever-growing, ever-changing, that Garden of Eden that we were intended to know. But most importantly, we would live in a renewed body, a body that knows no aging, no pain, no weariness, no illness, no grave, no tears. It is beyond anything we would ever imagine. A restored relationship with our Heavenly Father in which we will understand who He is and we will receive our assignment for eternity. I don't think we can ever quite comprehend what it's going to be like, but I trust our Heavenly Father and He is preparing a place for us to live with Him forever. In a world that is consumed with darkness, are you willing to share that hope that you have with the fact that Jesus loves you with someone you will cross paths with? Because it's not just about today. This idea that God loves us, that matters for eternity. I want you to close your eyes for a second. Just to take a couple seconds, just to let the Holy Spirit kind of speak to you. To understand the love that the Father has for you. God loves you. You can even say it, God loves me. God loves me. What does that love mean for you? Maybe you need to take a couple moments just to engage with that reminder that your Heavenly Father loves you. And maybe you're sitting here this morning and you're like, man, God, I'm so grateful for the things that you've done in my life. I need to go out and share that with people. And just taking a couple moments to engage with what God has for you, and just to think about somebody, maybe in your workplace, someone in your neighborhood, someone you see as you go grab a cup of coffee. Who is that person that needs to know that God loves them? Let's pray. Lord Jesus, it is an honor to be called your child. God, we're so grateful for what you have done for us. God, just for the fact that not only are you thinking about us today, God, but you're thinking about us for eternity. God, as we just take a couple moments to reflect on the fact that you love us, that you love me, God, I just pray that you will use your people to understand what that means. And God, that we would be a group of people who not only are committed to living that lifestyle found in John 3:16 and the following verses, but God, more importantly, that we would be committed to sharing that love with a world that just desires to live in darkness. God, we're grateful that you call us your child. We're grateful for that love. And all God's people said, amen.